Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the United States Institute of Peace. My name is Darren Cambridge, and I'm a senior program officer in our Center for Applied Conflict Transformation, and I'm going to be your host, your facilitator, your MC for this morning's event, which, as you know, is called Dr. Martin Luther King's Path to Peace, Reclaiming and Renewing Nonviolent Responses to Globalized Crises. Now, what you were hearing as you all made your way into the room today and found your seat is an excerpt from a speech that Dr. King gave the evening of April 3rd, 1968. The following morning on April 4th, on the balcony of his motel room in Memphis, Tennessee, he was tragically assassinated. And so today, April 4th, is the anniversary, the somber anniversary of that event, and it is also an opportunity for us to convene, come together, and give attention to what Dr. King stood for, what he fought for, and what he practiced, and how all that can be applied to the types of conflicts that we are facing today. Now, for those of you who are new or are unfamiliar with USIP, we are an institute that was founded by an act of Congress in 1984. So for our 30-plus year history, our vision has been a world free of violent conflict. A world free of violent conflict. And we do that, simply put, by making peace possible. By working with local stakeholders and communities in conflicts around the world in places like Pakistan, Burma, South Sudan, Colombia, and many other parts of the world. And we focus on a lot of different skills and ideas and practices in peace building, one of which is nonviolent action. That is a method of struggle that everyday people can and have used to fight against oppression, to advance and protect rights and freedoms, and to demand justice. And to do that by using methods such as strikes, boycotts, mass demonstrations, sit-ins, satire, vigils, other nonviolent methods. And so we've come together today in this special event to honor Dr. King's legacy, the power of nonviolent action, and how it applies to today's conflicts. Now, my colleague, Maria Stefan, who's not with us today, she's traveling, has really been spearheading USIP's work on advancing the research on nonviolent action, building and facilitating online courses and trainings on nonviolent action through our global campus, and by putting on workshops and special events dedicated to this topic and this skill. And so this is an effort towards that, bringing all of us together as a community to explore some of these questions and to look at this history. So with that, I want to get a good sense of the community that we have brought together here today. And I'm going to start by introducing our three panelists, all of whom are authors and educators who have edited books that are going to help us unpack some provocative and critical questions around nonviolence. So first, joining us, we have Dr. Maciej Bartkowski, who is Senior Director for Education at the International Center on Nonviolent Conflict, and he is the editor of this book called Recovering Nonviolent History, Resistance, Civil Resistance in Liberation Struggles. So he's going to share with us a little bit about this book and its importance to today's topic. We also have joining us Dr. Elavi Andura, who is a presidential fellow and a professor of education at George Mason University. And she is co-editor of this book, Exploring the Power of Nonviolence, Peace, Politics, and Practice. So she's going to share with us a little bit about the relevance and importance of this book and the questions that emerge from it. And last but certainly not least, we have Matt Meyer, who's an author, educator, and activist, and co-editor of this book, We Have Not Been Moved, Resisting Racism and Militarism in 21st Century America. Matt's work is also featured in Maciej's book and featured in Eloise's book. So thank you to the three of you for taking the time out of your day to be here with us and to honor Dr. King's legacy. We also have a number of people who are joining us and watching online. This event is organized in coordination with USIP's Global Campus. That is our online learning platform that provides online trainings and toolkits to learners from all across the world and various time zones. So I want to say welcome to all of our Global Campus learners who are joining and watching us online. We also have a class at George Mason University that is joining us virtually from their classroom. So they're watching. So I want to say welcome to our George Mason class that is joining us. And I'm going to actually ask all of our online participants to do something for us right now. I want you to send us a signal out there. And I want you to do that by, if you are on Twitter, sending us a tweet using the hashtag MLKLivesOn. This is also right here, hashtag MLKLivesOn. And I want you to send us a tweet telling us from where in the world you are joining or watching. So, for example, if you're watching from Medellin, Colombia, I want you to tweet hashtag MLKLivesOn in Medellin, Colombia. Or if you're joining or watching from Baghdad, Iraq, I want you to tweet hashtag MLKLivesOn in Baghdad, Iraq, et cetera, et cetera. And then my colleague, Stephen Reuter, is going to be on USIP's Twitter account. That's the handle at USIP. And he will be connecting with you via Twitter. So again, send us a signal using the hashtag MLKLivesOn and then from where in the world you're joining or watching. And the other thing I want to say is this is a discussion. And our panelists, yes, our panelists, but they are also instigators of conversation. That's the other primary role that they are playing here. And so they're going to be posing questions to all of you in the audience here and to our friends online. And they're going to be thought-provoking, reflective questions based on the theme of this event. And so our friends who are joining online, you are encouraged to participate in that portion of the event. And my colleague, Vanessa Francis, is on Skype. And so right now, I want you to open up Skype if you have an account, and I want you to connect with USIP_Global Campus. Again, that is USIP_Global Campus, and my colleague Vanessa will accept your invitation, and when we get to that portion of the show, she will facilitate a discussion with you on Skype, and perhaps we can bring some of you into the room here as well. So welcome to all of our online participants. And then, of course, we cannot forget those of you who made it here today on this beautiful day to be in the room with us. We have about 40 or so people joining us in the room. And the great thing about USIP when we do these events is that we always bring together an interesting, powerful, friendly group of individuals from all different walks of life and professions. And so I want to do a quick poll to get a sense of who is in the room here. So I'm going to throw out a couple labels that are connected with what we're going to talk about today. And if you identify with this label, just raise your hand. And you can identify with more than one of these labels. That's fine as well. You don't have to pick just one. So show of hands, how many of you identify as an educator, someone who teaches about nonviolent action? Okay, good. About, I'd say, 15 to 20. How many of you identify as a writer or a journalist or an author, someone who's writing and reporting on nonviolent movements and campaigns around the world? Show of hands. Okay, obviously our three panelists here and probably about three or so folks in the audience. Okay, great. How many of you identify as an activist, someone who is participating in organizing nonviolent movements or campaigns? Consider yourself an activist. Okay, good. So about, I'd say 10 or so. Okay, good. How many of you identify as a student? Someone who is learning. Yes, there you go. We are all students, as LV said. Okay, good. I like to see all these hands up. And how many of you identify as a policymaker, someone who's designing or shaping policy that is impacted by or affects nonviolent movements? Anyone who identifies as a policymaker? Okay, good. So I'd say about three or so folks in the audience. Okay, good. Good sense of who's in the room. And then my last question is, as many of you probably know, the invitation that went out for this event included an online poll that asked the question, it presented seven quotes from Dr. King, ranging from his speeches from 1958 to 1968. And it asked you, of these seven quotes, which one do you think is most relevant to the types of conflicts that we face in today's world. And we received over 200 responses from people around the world the few days leading up to this event. So show of hands, how many of you in this room had an opportunity to respond to that poll? Okay, so maybe like two or three or so, four. Okay, five. Okay, great, excellent. So anyway, like I said, we had over 200 people from around the world who responded to that poll, and the handout that you have on your seat is the are the results from that poll and some of the select responses from folks explaining why they chose the quote that, that they did. And that is actually going to be the starting question. Oh, yeah. Let's see here. Yeah, here we go. There's one. That's on there. Okay. Okay, great. I'm putting them on the spot here, our panelists on the spot. So you're in panelist role now, Elevi, Matt, and Maciej, before we jump to your critical questions. And so we had a lot of people around the world respond to this question, and so I want to pose this question to all of you. Which of these quotes from Dr. King do you think is most relevant to the types of conflicts, the types of violence, types of challenges that we face in today's world? And Matt, I might start with you because I know that you responded to the poll because I saw your response. So I know you've been thinking about it quite a bit. So Matt, I think you've got a mic. Great. Why don't you go ahead and share with us?
I think I responded saying I thought it was an unfair question. I rejected the question outright. You know, you begin by breaking the rules. That's the first lesson, isn't it? I said, you know, you asked me to choose who I love more, my son or my daughter. I can't do that. That's impossible. They're all fantastic quotes. I think I ended up choosing one, and I won't say which one it is because that would be playing the game. But you know, I think the main point on the serious side is I said when we were talking about this forum months ago. I feel like too often we engage in re-assassinating Dr. King. We play a role in accepting the idea that he ended in 1963. It's bad enough, tragic enough, that he was killed in 68. But the idea that somehow there's this frozen I have a dream moment in 63 and that nothing happened after that is a mistake that we in some ways allow ourselves to get caught up in. So I was extremely excited to hear about the way in which you were putting together today and the way in which those quotes reflected a larger breadth of his thinking and his thoughts. We have to breathe life, I think, into that period, 63 to 68, militant moments where King and many others became more internationalist, became more focused on economics. And I think part of the reason we need to do that is we're in such a moment today. We're in a movement-building moment today. We're in a Black Lives Matter, a Dream Defenders, a movement-building moment today, a Ferguson truth-telling moment today. And the truth is that things have not gotten as better as we'd like to sometimes think they have. And there's still a lot of work to be done. I think that we're at a time when we need to resurrect the calls for freedom now. Because clearly, we're still at a point where white lives seem to matter most. And so I appreciated those later quotes, and I appreciated the whole list of them.
Thank you, Matt. Elevi, your thoughts.
To one particular one that I have even quoted in my work several times. This is about injustice and mutuality. Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. We are caught in an inescapable network of mutuality, tied in a single garment of destiny. Whatever affects one directly affects all indirectly. All my writings and my work, even the way I raise my own family, is grounded on the principle of interdependence. And when we think about interdependence, we must also think automatically about social responsibility. And sometimes we are so busy protecting what we believe is our own. I still haven't figured that out, you know, what's mine and what's yours, because really nothing belongs to us. We are here on Earth temporarily. We borrow, even worse, we steal the land of people. We borrow or we self-appropriate what's supposed to belong to other people. And yet, most of the conflicts around the world, including here in the United States, are really caused by this lack of consciousness, this lack of realization that really nothing is mine here on Earth. But especially in the United States, I remember the first cultural lesson I learned upon arriving many, many years back. People were talking about my doctor, my professor, my car, my wife. And I said, oh, wow. And so I concluded by my first month or so that this is very interesting. People own everything here. So there is no mention of ours. And I think that's fundamentally one of the major issues, because we are so focused on our own well-being and we miss the important message, the important duty, and the important responsibility of reclaiming whatever links us, what ties us together as humanity. When we engage in wars all over around the world, we think, you know, okay, people are dying in Rwanda, people are die all the time in Burundi. Oh, by the way, the war in Iraq, that's over there. There are some children dying, but it's so far away. It's their problem. And then we realize it's our problem. It took me a long time to help my students understand that all the conflicts and all the dying and all the wars around the world are really our problems. We are so materialistic to the point that blinds us to our responsibility to care for one another. And this is when I think about Dr. King and what he died for, I sometimes wonder if he's turning around in his grave. He gave his life for all of us. Not just in the United States. He gave his life for the cause of freedom and justice for all of us from around the world. I mean, you have to hear children in Africa reciting the I Have a Dream and reflecting the I Have a Dream speech and realize, oh my goodness, Dr. King for the world. And yet we forget that we are here to ameliorate, to enhance one another's well-being. And I think that's fundamentally where we fail to honor Dr. King's legacy.
Thank you, Elvie. And I actually think your reflections touch on, I think, a lot of these quotes, not just the injustice quote. Maciej, let's turn to you. Which quote do you think is most relevant to what we're facing in today's world?
Yeah, it was a difficult choice, I must say. And I would go with the one that got the least votes,
good,
which is the last one, which is nonviolent resistance is not aimed against oppressors, but against oppression. And I'm surprised that actually it got the least votes. But one of the respondents I really liked was a person from Macedonia. Vladimir Delov, he says that, you know, we need to strive to change the game, not switch the players. And I think when I look at the successful civil resistance campaigns, I see that they were engaged as much in trying to transform the societies as they were trying to challenge the oppression and indirectly opponent. When I look at the Polish solidarity struggle in the 70s, or the precursor to solidarity struggles in the 70s and then in the 80s, they engage in as much constructive actions as disruptive ones. And the highlight was that civil resistance is a moderating force, and as a moderating force, it's always open to negotiations and dialogue. But you cannot really engage in a truthful and genuine dialogue with the opponent unless that opponent recognizes the power of civil resistance. And that power of civil resistance would be illustrated in two kind of elements or factors. One is through the engagement in disruptive actions like strikes, boycotts, demonstrations. but also in a transformation of the society that is liberated even before that liberation comes or is truly established. So in the movements, people engage in democratic practices, in building alternative institutions, in constructive program. They, for example, despite the censorship, they control circulation of information. Despite the formal control of the school system, they controlled education. Despite the fact that the government may have controlled employment, the movement controlled the livelihood or influenced the livelihood of the people. So during the resistance, there was liberation and transformation of the society going on. And it was more less about challenging directly the opponent and really liberating the society from that oppression that they were subject to. And so as my colleague Jack Duval says, it's nonviolent movements were incubators of democracy, and they were practicing democracy before that democracy was formally established. And that's what is characteristics for many nonviolent movements, that we, the ones that were very truly successful. So I thought this quote was really important, that we need to struggle not only with opponent, but we really need to struggle with ourselves, and first of all transform ourselves before we can establish more peaceful and nonviolent societies. And I think the teaching and lessons and legacy of Martin Luther King points to this, the depthness of the transformation within ourselves that need to take place and happen before we can think about reinvented type of relationships and more peaceful societies that we try to build.
Thanks, Maciej. So we're going to move now to the discussion portion of this event, as this is a forum. And all of our panelists, or as I kind of called them earlier, instigators of conversation, have actually developed questions that they want to pose to all of you in the audience and to our folks who are watching online around the world. These are questions that are rooted in the themes in their book. So if we could bring up on the screen the slide so we can have a visual representation of these questions as well. And we are going to start with Elavi. And as I mentioned at the beginning, she's the co-editor of this book, Exploring the Power of Nonviolence, Peace Politics and Practice. So very briefly, tell us why this book is important for people who want to think about the role of nonviolence in today's world. And then tell us what question you want to pose to our audience. It's on. You got it.
All right. Well, one primary goal for this book was to inspire deeper reflection. Because sometimes we are so busy planning and creating plans for nonviolence. So we're going to demonstrate there, we're going to do this, we're going to do a sitting there, and we miss the reflection that has to really ground and shame and frame the actual actions that we engage in. So I wanted people to reflect first in their writing and inspire the audience, the readers, to think and reflect about their own intentions. Sometimes we forget that who am I? Why is this important to me? Why am I going to engage in nonviolence action? What are the ultimate results that I'm hoping for? And what qualifies me? What pushes me? Equally important goal was to demonstrate that we don't have to self-divide in pursuing this work. I'm an activist, I'm a scholar, I'm a policymaker. To kind of build that bridge from scholarship to activism, because I was convinced, Randall Amster, the co-editor, and I were convinced that the true responses to the major questions that the world faces are really located at the nexus of scholarship and practice, which is a bridge we tend to miss sometimes. So that's where, in conceptualizing the book, that's what we wanted to capture. So social responsibility and the bridge that connects, the nexus, the responses to the major questions are right here. It's not the activists who have it right. There is no right or wrong. It's not the scholars who have it right. There is no right or wrong. And sometimes we miss that nexus. So that's why my question was asking people to reflect. I can't see it, so I can't read it. So I'm going to paraphrase it. So in other words, what is the foundation of your action? What are the principles that drive your actions on a daily basis? It's basically the simplest question, why do you do what you do? So please reflect, I said, on the following two questions. So there are two. What is the foundation and of your principles and the essence of your actions? And in what ways does this foundation illuminate your sociocultural path and your views of nonviolence? And this was intentional because, as a member of a peace studies community, ever since Matt's paths and mine crossed many, many years back, I continue to be challenged, and I continue to challenge my colleagues in the movement to open their eyes and their hearts and their ears to wonder who is missing here in this movement. Because we go to conferences, we write books, and most of the time there are people who are missing, as if there is only one group of people who can engage in nonviolence or who know the value and understand the value of nonviolence. So it's my challenge to diversity here. To inclusiveness. In fact, as I was thinking early this morning, wondering what am I going to say there, and then I thumbed through the book very, very quickly and landed on the really a great sentence in the book, in the conclusion that I drafted, which reminds us that love, education, and inclusiveness are the essence of the work that we engage in to advance nonviolence. So I want everybody to think, who are you? Why do you do what you do? What's nonviolence for you?
Great. Thank you. And I want to remind our folks who are joining us online that we want you to participate in responding to these questions as well. So we are on Skype. The account name is USIP_Global Campus. Again, that's USIP_Global Campus. So log into Skype, connect with that account. My colleague Vanessa will accept your invitation. And when we engage in discussion, she will facilitate that for all of you on Skype. So let's now turn to Maciej. And again, his book that he edited is Recovering Nonviolent History, Civil Resistance in Liberation Struggle. So Maciej, very briefly tell us, why is this book important for folks to read when we're looking at nonviolence in today's context, and what's the critical question that you want folks to talk about today?
Sure, we talk about Martin Luther King legacy, and oftentimes talking about legacy of nonviolent resistance is very difficult, and it's occluded by what I think, what I call free denials, which we, together with a number of authors in Recovering Nonviolent History, we explored denials about civil resistance, denial of the existence of civil resistance, that it played an important role in significant historical processes, denial of legitimacy of civil resistance, and denial of effectiveness of civil resistance. And those three denials, we try to which we are looking into them while analyzing liberation struggles, where indeed, when one look at the rise of the nation states, one really hear more about wars, about violence, about violent nationalism, about violent breakout of empires, about violent interventions, that they all led to the rise of the nation states. Or we hear about structural processes that enabled those nations to emerge. Urbanization, migration, industrialization. Or we talked about elites, political, military, economic elites, the kind of fathers of the nations that brought about that nations into existence. And we at the same time deny the existence of agency of ordinary people and actions, non-violent collective actions of ordinary people in that particular history. Some who would kind of go against the what I would call the legitimacy of civil resistance would also say that civil resistance it's a form of pacifism, it's a form of defeatism, it's a form of surrender. So how that kind of form could have helped nations to win their self-determination rights? So they deny the legitimacy in that sense. And finally, people would say that those who would think that civil resistance is not effective, they would say, we oftentimes would use the term power holders. So if we use the term power holders, who we think about? Do we think about ordinary people or actually elites, those who are in position of, they are prime ministers, presidents, those they have real power. Whereas we try to redefine what is what means power holder. Power holder can be an ordinary person. Oftentimes that political power is dormant in every one of us until people come together and start organizing. That would be the moment where people would harness that dormant political power. So we look into those denials in the context oftentimes of glorified violence and romanticized violence in the struggles for the nation. And we try to debunk those myths, looking at cases that stretch from Africa, North America, Europe, Asia. And we are showing that civil resistance was taking place under different geographies, in nations that would have different cultures, different religions, that would have different political systems. A number of those civil resistance struggles preceded Gandhi. And in fact, we can see the diffusion of the ideas of nonviolent resistance through those cases. Gandhi learned about civil resistance while looking at a nonviolent resistance of Hungarians in 19th century against Austrians, and that led to the winning of the rights in a form of dual monarchy. Gandhi was looking into what was going on in Ireland and Irish independence struggle. I mean, eventually it took the final turn, but Arthur Griffith, one of the leaders of Irish nationalist movement, was very much engaged in planning nonviolent resistance, and Gandhi knew about that. Then, of course, Martin Luther King took a lot from Gandhi. If I look at solidarity movement, they would look into actions and ideas and thoughts of Gandhi to inspire their own struggle, and so on. So we also explored the diffusion of ideas on nonviolent resistance across cases, as well as debunking all those various myths and denials.
And so what was the question that you wanted to pose to our audience here? It's behind you if you can see it.
Right. It's a bit long, but in essence, the question is asking the audience to look into their communities, societies, and nations and see what is celebrated. Whether you've got acknowledgement, or if you look at the national holidays, that might be the easiest way. If you look at national holidays of your countries and the celebrations, when you have a free day from work, who do you celebrate or what do you celebrate? Do you celebrate the end of the violent conflict? Do you celebrate the winning of independence by your country through violence? Do you celebrate the heroes who took up arms and defended your freedom or won your freedom? Or you celebrate nonviolent movements, nonviolent collective actions, figures that would embrace nonviolent resistance? So if we could, you know, look at those national holidays in your countries, what do you celebrate? And then we can see to what extent perhaps violent events get much more recognition in national psyche and discourse, and then to what extent nonviolent resistance is recognized.
Thanks, Maciej. And then last, again, Matt Myers' book that he co-edited, We Have Not Been Moved, Resisting Racism and Militarism in 21st Century America. So Matt, tell us, why is this book an important one for folks to read, given today's context, and what's the critical question that you want folks to talk about?
I will answer that question, unlike the previous one. But before I do that, you know, it occurs to me there's a bridge. I was just reflecting on this, Maciej, when you were talking about the diffusion and this question of movements that were influenced in these ways before Gandhi. But I think it's also interesting, and we explore those as well in the book, of movements that came about after and directly challenging and in some ways against Gandhi and King. Movements that said, oh, no, this nonviolent stuff has failed. And yet when we look more carefully at the construction of those movements, the foundation even of some of those movements were in unarmed nonviolent civil resistance, which I think makes the question, it underscores the question, makes the question even more, in contemporary terms, fascinating. I mean, here it is, we've not only, you talk about denied, but we've not only ignored it, we've actually said we're against it.
Right. So some of those,
and yet we haven't really been.
Some of those movements were hijacked by then an armed approach and that dominated the resistance.
Yeah, I perhaps wouldn't use the word hijacked, but still, yes, indeed. And I think those shifts are key, and I think in some ways, we have not been moved, developed in large part from King's writings towards the end of his life about the giant triplets, right? And he was mainly talking about U.S. society, but I think he was also internationalizing. Racism, militarism, and materialism. And we focused on those two. We focused on racism and militarism in this book because, you know, even with those two, we still came out to about 700 pages. But I think, in part, the title derives from a sense that we as the co-editors had about an historic call to white folks, an historic call for folks to dig deep in our own communities, to stand up, to step up, and struggle against white supremacy and racism in our institutions, in our own pockets of power, everywhere. And I feel like, when I was thinking about coming here today, I was thinking about the fairly recent and popular book by Rebecca Solnit, Men Explain Things to Me, which is just a great title. Even if you don't read the book, it's just a great title. And I was thinking, we actually, I think, at this moment, more than ever, probably didn't back in King's time, but now more than ever, we don't need a bunch of white professors, pardon, telling us how brilliant King was. See, we don't need that. We need a bunch of white professors and white everything to be more engaged in the more dangerous but profound work of calling out how bad things are still and how we need to change them. Yes, in a hopeful context, while building the beloved community, but also in a way that deconstructs the institutions that still are propagating white supremacy, not just in the U.S., but globally. You know, I think I worry sometimes when I hear us talk about this man who died for all of us, because it sounds like another man when you talk about that. And I think we need to get away from the iconization. We need to get away from the idea that we had this saint here that we can only replicate, that we can only act like if we too ourselves become saints. And I feel like that's confusing on many, many levels, both if you look at the man, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., but also if you look at movement building. I think those who would like the status quo to remain the same all the time, those who have power keep power, those who have do not, would very much like it to sound like we have to only be saints. And he, of course, was a saint. Because then it's an unachievable goal. King, first and foremost, aside from being a strategic political thinker like Gandhi, was a risk taker. He was a political prisoner. He thought it was all about putting your life on the line for justice, for freedom now, for not waiting. Right? Why We Can't Wait. That was one of the early books, even before 67, 68. for moving in a militant way, non-militaristic, non-violent, but a militant way for change now. And to emulate him, we need to move out of our comfort zones. And I think the biggest we of all is what's happening in the white communities in the US, and on an international level, what's happening in this dynamic between the oppressed and the oppressors. Because some of us find ourselves racially, or maybe in terms of gender, or maybe in terms of one's own community and state, a little more leaning in the power than in the powerless. And so my question had to do with that challenge. What do those of us who have some power, as a man in a sexist society, as a white person in a racist society, in a time when movements are building up, Black Lives Matter and others, in a burgeoning militant moment, what do we do with the institutional, interpersonal, but fundamental power dynamics that we're confronting?
Thank you, Matt. All right, so we've got a lot to unpack here. We've got our three questions from our panelists, or from rather our instigators of conversation. So what I'm going to ask you all to do now is turn to one or two people who are sitting around you, in front of you, behind you, next to you, ideally someone that you do not know. Because as I said, one of the great things about bringing folks together in this building is that it's folks from different walks of life, different professions, different motivations, and it'd be great if we could walk away from this convening having learned something about somebody else and their perspective, something that you haven't met. So think about any one of these questions, and for
watching you, don't, if you're married to, or like a sister, or best friends with, we're watching you. I'm sorry.
No, we are watching. We are watching. And so choose any one of these questions that you want to discuss in that small group, and for 10 minutes, you're going to unpack that question. And at the end of that 10 minutes, I'm going to go around from different group to group, and we're going to see what emerged from those conversations. And then that is what our panelists are going to react to. So what we're going to talk about for the rest of this event is born out of what came out in your conversations and what you think with somebody that you don't necessarily know. Our friends who are joining us online, again, connect with us on Skype at USIP_global campus. Again, that's USIP_global campus. And my colleague Vanessa will facilitate a conversation with you via Skype. And I'm going to go around, and if groups are amenable to this, just so folks who are watching online, they can see what's happening in the room and hear what's happening in the room, I'm going to pop in probably group to group and just kind of get a sense of what folks are talking about, what questions they're discussing, so we can keep our online audience engaged as well. And I encourage our panelists, if you want to get up and move your feet to pop in on some of these groups, you're welcome to do that as well. So our 10 minutes of discussion, based off of these three questions, choose one to talk about in your group, begins now.
Yeah.
Do I use, keep using this mic?
Yeah.
Check one, check two. Okay. Okay. All right. So to folks who are watching online, I'm going to be going around to some of the different groups, and we're going to hear what folks are talking about. And again, you are encouraged, if you want to insert your own perspectives, your own ideas into this conversation, connect with us on Skype with the account USIP_global campus. Again, that's USIP_global campus. But for now, I'll be roaming the room and we'll hear what some of the other groups are talking about.
What do we really do to celebrate these holidays? That's kind of just my question. What do you guys think about the celebrated versus ignored holidays?
I took it from a different kind of standpoint. I think that we celebrate Dr. King, but we don't celebrate Malcolm X in the same way. And I think that the reason that is because when it comes to people of color and being violent, it's a terrible thing. Granted, like you said, Columbus Day is something completely different. But I think that if Dr. King hadn't had the opposing force of Malcolm X, I do not think that his nonviolent movement would have been accepted. It was almost a preferred method. It was like, if you give us two methods between Malcolm X's kind of like being radical and Dr. King, we're going to choose Dr. King. And so I think that it would be a lot different if we didn't have those two forces. But obviously, I think they do choose to celebrate the nonviolent and criticize the violent as if they didn't kind of play with each other.
And the fact it's so limited what's celebrated, you know? It's like we only celebrate, like what he was saying earlier about what the dream part of it's only the part that's celebrated, you know? Nobody thinks about the main part of it. Like I was having this argument with my girlfriend earlier about how Rosa Parks, like everybody just thinks bus. Like that's it. You know, she spent her entire life, you know, doing these things, being an activist, like from beginning to end. And it's kind of just like bus, you know? I just don't understand why everything just stops there and we don't celebrate the person, we celebrate that one moment in history. I don't know. Things like that.
This is the question on kind of why do we celebrate or not celebrate certain things and how does that color our sense of our own history?
I do find it interesting that, as one of the professors said earlier, that we do celebrate events that are violent, right? But we don't celebrate non-violent forms of demonstrations or other kind of boycotts, for example. Maybe because also violent events happen on a certain day, so it's easier to grasp them. But in the same sense, of course, you have demonstrations that take place on a certain day. So it is actually possible also to celebrate those events. But I don't really know why we don't actually celebrate them. Do you know?
Pop around here to some other groups. We'll join this one over here and see what they're talking about. Sorry, do you mind if I jump into this group a little bit? Our online audience might be watching, so they might
fantastic.
Want to hear some things that are being discussed here. So I'm sorry to interrupt. Please go ahead.
So
I found out that the president was holding rallies throughout the country because it's election season. And I jumped into a car with my cousin, and we followed him throughout the country from village to village. And eventually the NIA found out that I was there. They questioned, which is the version of the CIA, and they wanted to know why I was following the president around. And eventually, at the end of the country, he didn't meet with me, but he had all his cabinet members. He's like, you know, this little girl has been following us for days. Someone needs to sit with her and find out why she's here. And I met with all the ministers and then met with him. And 2 days later, he came out and banned FGM, and then Parliament passed it. So I think to me that shows that sometimes we underestimate what we can do, because I tried, but I never thought that it was going to happen. And when Gambia banned FGM, we didn't think Parliament was going to pass a bill. And for that to happen, when you look at FGM, it's a practice that's been around for centuries. And currently you have 200 million women in Africa, Asia, and Middle East that are living with this practice. It affects not only their well-being, but it affects their sexual lives. It affects everything about them, their God-given right of being a woman. And for us to be able to change that, to me, it's and like when I think about people that I look up to in history, it's Dr. King, and we have Nelson Mandela, and those are the people that inspire me to do what I'm doing. So it's
I'm just passing around the screenshot from your Twitter posting with the headline. Do you want to tell them about this? I mean, it's just so fantastic, the work that you've done in the Gambia and the work that you're continuing to do.
I mean,
It's a baby, after the law was passed, we found out that a 5-month-old baby died as a result of FGM. And I called the president's office and I said, look, the world is watching you. When you look at Gambia, we don't have a good track record when it comes to human rights and all of that. And for us to pass a law and not be able to do anything about it, and a baby died as a result of something, and we pushed them, and now we have the first conviction, and it's only been months. And now other countries in Africa are looking at us to be a template for their countries, because we're a small country and we're really able to effect change. And because of that, we're going to use the Gambia model to take it to other places. And I'm very honored and proud to be on the right side of history. I mean, when I started my campaign, I always said I don't want to be a poster child for this issue. And now it feels like I'm the poster child for the issue. But at the same time, we're doing something right. So being a poster child for the issue, as much as I don't want that, but it's good to know that we are making change, and change is coming.
Let's take 5 more minutes. Okay, I'm going to jump into this group here and see what they're talking about.
Hopefully we find the answer here.
Yeah. What question is this group talking about?
We're focusing primarily on 1 and 3. Yeah, and see the relationship between them. Yeah.
Do you mind if I jump in? Okay, great. Yeah, no, I'm not going to say anything. I'm just, our online audience might want to hear some things that have been coming up in this group. So the mic is connected to our online feed.
We were talking about in terms of spirituality and just faith, and how, in a sense, it can act as our foundation for pursuing anything in the service realm. And we found it interesting how, in a society where we, as a whole, we kind of gear away from that, and we wonder why we have the issues that we do, when we can't talk about it in the workplace, or we could barely talk about it at coffee shops, because it's so, what's that word? Give me that word. It's just, you know, when you want to talk about something, but you, so taboo, you know, so many different levels of taboo with it that we're trying to figure out. I think in this group right here, we're trying to find the solutions. So that's kind of why we're just, our mind is wrapping around that right now. So we're hoping to get some type of answers from here as the discussion goes further. Yeah, how to navigate that. Mm-hmm.
I was just going to say, you know, you start to dig a little bit deeper into King, and you see these, you know, strong commitments that he has to his faith, and how that sort of undergirds everything that he does. And at the same time, see him drawing from people that don't share that faith, and using those things as well. So we're just talking about the first one in terms of, if we are moving away from sort of some of these spiritual things that would be the base of nonviolent resistance or service or whatever it is, what now serves as that foundation? Can we have a strong commitment without something, or do we have to create something or go back to something? You know what I mean? But there's still,
you can find the balance. Right? A balance between integrity and, I don't know, integrity and peace, or really, really don't know, humanity. But humanity, right? Just humanity in general, back to the basic moral human code, which I think is kind of long forgotten, in a sense, between politics and education. It's just certain things we don't discuss anymore.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. I'm going to circle around. All right, I'm going to go to one more group. Perhaps we'll go to this one back here and see what they're talking about. Okay.
Yeah.
We're bringing in domestic politics here, I see. Yeah, unavoidable this conversation.
About how much violent protests or violent movements, they get more attention than non-violent. It's a product of the media and the society itself. So.
It's part of our culture that, you know, violence is celebrated or highlighted more than peace, unfortunately. But we thought it was interesting where he mentioned about the holidays, what we celebrate, because that really struck a chord when you think about what it is we usually celebrate, except for maybe those who, and you mentioned, who are Christians and we celebrate Christmas, you know, that is a symbol of peace, you know. So. But outside of that, everything else seemed to represent. And the other thing we noticed about Dr. King's message, it only seems, and I'm just talking from the time I'm living here, I wasn't born here, but it seems like it's only Black History Month that he's highlighted and his legacy is talked about in some respects. But outside of that, that's not a benchmark that is used.
Learn this as children, you know, in school, it's part of our curriculum, Martin Luther King, Martin Luther King Day, Black History Month, but as adults, it passes out. I mean, I was not even aware that today was the anniversary of that. Just, it's gone from I think, from your consciousness, like just...
All right. Good to see you, by the way. all right, let's wrap up these conversations. And again, for those of you who are watching us online, we're going to wrap up our conversations now. You can continue connect with my colleague on Skype. That's USIP_global campus. And encourage you to continue using the hashtag MLK Lives On as we hear what some of the groups have talked about and what has emerged from these conversations. All right, folks, let's wrap up the thought, the sentence that you are on. You can stay in your circles. You don't have to go back to your seats. We can stay in our groups here. And we have about 25, 30 minutes now to hear what emerged from your group conversations. And as someone who went around and popped into different groups, there's a lot of rich stuff that I think we're going to get a chance to talk about. So is there one group that would like to first have one person volunteer stand up? I'll come and give them the mic and share with us what emerged from your conversation in response to these questions, and then see how our panelists react. Is there a group that would like to start? If not, there's one that I have in mind that I'll pick, but I'll wait for someone to volunteer. Okay, great. Let's start here. Tell us your name and what emerged in the conversation you had with your group.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Hashim Eltine. I'm the founder and president of the International Peace Quest Institute. I consider myself as a disciple of Martin Luther King and all the people inspired by peace, really, and nonviolence, but very, very committed to changing the world. I think what came out of our exchange with regard to these very interesting pieces of work, and I commend the authors and the presentations, and of course the moderator. Let me be personal. In 1963, when Martin Luther King spoke around here at the Lincoln and said the I Have a Dream speech, I was a student leader in Africa, in an African university, and we were social democrats. Watching the presidential election and the calls of Bernie Sanders, men streaming social democracy in American political discourse makes me smile, because at the time in 63 we were seeing, you know, while capitalism is no good, hardcore Marxism is no good. How about democratic socialism? And of course this is rooted in my African solidarity kind of community, and what Madame said, Elavi, earlier, you know, a spiritual rooting of our cultures in Africa, which is that really don't own anything, that we are here in a journey, and a short one, and that we are supposed to do good, you know, and move on. But anyway, I said about Sanders and his mainstreaming socialism and democracy. Now, listening to this, I chuckle and I say, oh my goodness, this is interesting. We were social democrats in 63, and America is perhaps finally catching up with us in terms of ideas. You know, but to come to the issue here, honestly, listening to you and coming here and so on, and watching the debate, I love watching and experiencing as a citizen in this country this vibrant debate and discussion in the elections. I love Elavi Ndura's emphasis on reflection, deep thought, consciousness, and I will go further actually. At this juncture in our human history, in America's history, and America being the Noah's Ark of the 21st century of humanity, you know, therefore, by when I speak of American experiment, I speak really about global experiment and about world perspective. I think the challenges that we face today cannot be addressed by the status quo and the old paradigm. We need absolutely a new paradigm. We need a paradigm shift. We have to be serious about that. And which means we have to be humble, we who have power, anywhere, everywhere, in institutions, in parties, and so on. We have to be humble that we can't address the issues that face us today with same old vision. We need a new vision, an audacious new vision, and that cannot be attained without not only consciousness, but actually a human and humane awakening that will liberate us from the three evils of the dominant systems: racism, militarism, and greed. And also, we have to be serious about the narrative, because we have an official narrative that is false, and we have to come clean with the narratives so that we have a serious conversation about narratives, agree on a narrative that we can all relate to, and from there use it as a source and a foundational core from which we can invent a new vision of governance that makes sense. And thank you, Bernie Sanders.
Thank you. All right, I'm gonna. There's a lot from that in terms of paradigm shift, some of the connections to
politics that are happening here. I want to hear from two other groups very briefly so we can give our panelists enough time to react. I wanted to go to this group back here. I think something interesting emerged. Can you share with us your thought very briefly so we have enough time to hear from one other group?
Hello, my name is Sabria Whitaker. I'm a senior at the University of Illinois, but I'm interning with the Office of the Attorney General. And so from my background, my mom marched with Dr. King when she was younger in Alabama, and my dad actually fought in Vietnam. So I've always been kind of informed about their thoughts on what was going on. And so I think that, you know, when it comes to wars in other countries and when the oppressed group fights back, it's celebrated. But when it comes to people of color, it's almost preferred that we are not nonviolent. And so my understanding is if, yes, you know, I have a dream, that and everything inspired the nonviolent movement, but I don't think it would have been as successful if it weren't for Malcolm X, because it was the understanding from the power in America and just, you know, the white supremacy, that if we have two movements of these people of color and one is nonviolent and the other is violent, we prefer the nonviolent movement. That's what we choose to rise up, and that's who we're gonna back and let create change, because we're gonna resist that nonviolent movement.
Thank you. So some of the distinctions between MLK and Malcolm X and what impact that had on how the various movements were perceived. And I want to hear from this group over here, and then we're going to turn to our panelists. Would you care to share briefly a little bit about your story and how MLK and his legacy is connected with that?
My name is Jaha Dukure, and I am originally from the Gambia. I am the founder and executive director of a nonprofit organization called Safe Hands for Girls. We work on the issue of female genital mutilation, which is also known as female circumcision. And back in 2014, I started my organization because I saw that there was a lot of girls in my community here in America that were impacted by this issue, but no one was speaking for them. So we decided to start a change.org petition and asked the Obama administration to look into this issue and see the number of women that are impacted by the issue. And over 220,000 people signed that petition, and the Obama administration commissioned the CDC to conduct the study and found that over 500,000 women are currently living in the United States with female genital mutilation. And after that study came out, I decided to take my campaign to Gambia, where I'm originally from. In the Gambia, 75% of women have been impacted by FGM. And I knew that there was a lot of work that was being done, and for 30 years, there's been organization that has been campaigning to end this issue, but nothing has happened, no change has happened. And I knew that the only way we can actually get change, it has to come from the president, it has to come from the top. So I found out that the president was conducting rallies throughout the country, and I decided to borrow a car. My cousin decided to follow me, and we had a camera guy with us, so we traveled throughout the country following him from village to village. And at the end of the country, after like days of just following him and being questioned, being detained, and finally he authorized all his cabinet members to sit down with me and find out what I wanted. And when I explained to them why this issue was important to us as young people, and being someone that went through this practice when I was a week old, and the impact that it has had on my life and all the women that it continues to impact. 2 days after meeting with him, Gambia banned FGM. 3 weeks later, Parliament came out with a bill and passed it unanimously. And it's a movement building. What we started in the United States, it's looking at people like Dr. King and what they did through the civil rights movement, looking at Nelson Mandela and what he went through to make sure that apartheid ends in South Africa, is what inspires me and what makes me believe that we can also change this. I know that it's different from slavery, but when you look at it, it's all that culture of abuse. It's all that culture of supremacy, whether you're a woman or a man. This is something that impacts. And I don't think this is just an African issue. It's happening in Indonesia. It's happening in India. It's a world issue, and it has to take all of us coming together to make sure that it ends in our generation foot binding, for instance, ended in China within 10 years. And I think if we make this a priority, we can end FGM in our generation.
Thank you. So let's turn back to our panelists now. And a couple things that I heard. One was obviously the impact of this conversation on looking at a paradigm shift. And he mentioned the idea of democratic socialism, a word that has come up in American politics in the election this year, which of course has ramifications internationally. We heard about the distinction or contrast or perceived contrast between MLK and Martin Luther King and, MLK and Malcolm X, and how that impacted how civil rights struggle was treated or people reacted to it. And then lastly, I think also what we heard from this story is movements around the world today that are these current contemporary living examples of some of the principles of organizing for justice and for rights. So who would like to begin? There's a lot of seeds that were just planted. Who would like to react to some of these comments first?
Oh, so I'm starting, right? All right. Well, I will not address all the main points that have been raised so that my colleagues can chime in as well. Paradigm shift and narrative making are the two constructs that caught my attention. And of course, the MLK versus Malcolm X in movement building. You know, sometimes we are caught up in a framework of either or to arrive at the goals that we are pursuing. Nonviolence is not just an idea. It's not just a goal to something or to somewhere. In my mind, nonviolence is a journey going to someplace. And if we were ever to think that there is one way to arrive at where we are going, we might be shortchanged a little bit. And that means the way we contribute to the journey, we have to think first, where are we going? You know, we know we have inequity worldwide. We know we have colonialism that lingers on, even as we see it here in the United States. Colonialism has not ended. Slavery, yes, the laws have been passed against slavery, but we see the consequences, the legacy of slavery every single time when we turn around. So this means that as the problems we encounter on a daily basis continue to be more complex, so must the solutions. The solutions must be complex as well. Poverty leads to some of the violence that we see around. Inequities, and sometimes we don't realize how everything is linked. So the paradigm shift and the narrative that we need to create is real. And that's why I'm connecting very strong with my friend's Matt Myers urge to look around us, look within us. What am I going to help to frame the solutions to these problems that we are encountering? Yes, social democracy, it's very, very appealing, because we have to realize that some of us, we are sitting here in this forum, whether long distance or right in person, because we actually had something to eat last night. And some of us even were so privileged that we had breakfast. And we are so privileged, we actually got some sleep. We had a place to sleep somewhere. So we are here engaged. We can think, we can debate. There are people who cannot be in this room because their concern is not tomorrow. Their concern is today. Where am I going to sleep? Where my baby is going to sleep tonight? What's my two-year-old going to eat tonight, and sometimes we forget we forget that even being he is a major privilege. So I think what we are standing here, what we are sharing, and what we are sharing with the gentleman over there, is that, and Matt said it so clearly and so strongly, with every privilege comes responsibilities. So we're looking up to Sanders, we're looking up to Martin Luther King, we're looking up, some of us, to Malcolm X, we're looking up to Nelson Mandela, we're looking up to Ndadaye in Burundi, but all comes to back to us. What have we learned from them that gives us the inspiration and the power and the responsibility to really to make a difference? And unless we circle back, nonviolence will continue to be an illusion, because nonviolence is it's not an abstract thing. We have to go back to wonder what's violence anyway, because violence is not just, you know, somebody with a gun shooting at me. It's somebody who makes it impossible for me to achieve my own professional and personal goals. It's somebody who abuses me psychologically, emotionally, financially. So violence is multifaceted, and therefore nonviolence, the nonviolence movement must also be multifaceted and nourished by all these contributions and ideas and commitments that we all share. And the movement, it has to be grounded in, first of all, the recognition of the privileges that we have, and therefore of the major responsibilities that we have individually and collectively.
Thank you, Elvie. Matt? Oh, Majay.
Sure. I want to reflect maybe on two things. First, it's what I would call, or what scholars would call, the violent flank as part of civil resistance or nonviolent movements. And we have known movements where those violent flanks were present. South Africa might be one of the examples where ANC would turn into violent resistance after Soweto massacre in 1960. Then in 1980s, then UDF would lead nonviolent resistance. And some would look into civil rights movement and Malcolm X and says that the kind of threat or use of violence was helpful for nonviolent movement. And there are two schools about this. One school would say that indeed the presence of the violent flank helps civil resistance movements. Helps because, for example, civil resistance movements would be seen as moderate force, and the opponent or adversary would be more willing to negotiate with those who would use nonviolent resistance rather than arms. So the armed flank is kind of helping indirectly nonviolent movements. But there is also a counter-argument or arguments. So one of them would be that oftentimes the adversary would use a presence of violence, even if that violence is limited to a radical group, against all dissidents. And the whole movement would be labeled terrorists and would provide justification for adversary to use violence. And that's why some people would say that maintaining nonviolent discipline makes that the use of repression less likely and less justified in the eyes of the general public if the movement maintains nonviolent discipline rather than when there is a violent flank. My colleagues, Erika Chenoweth and Kurt Schock, did a piece that was published in Mobilization Journal in December that looked specifically at the impact of violent flank on civil resistance to see whether it's positive or negative. And there was a they included statistical analysis in that, and they determined that there is no really direct impact, whether positive or negative, of violent flank on nonviolent movements, but there is a negative indirect impact of violent flank on nonviolent movements, which was associated with the decreasing level of participation. So less people were willing to join nonviolent movement when there was a violent flank present during the struggle. And since participation is a really crucial element in the success of nonviolent movement, then indirectly the violent flank decreased the chances of those movements being successful by decreasing the participation in them. So this is a kind of scholarly work, but done across a number of cases. And it may vary from case to case, but overall, violent flag has a negative impact. And my second comment is about, which is related, thought maybe not directly to the very inspiring story of the FGM movement, where we see those movements right around the world, kind of being built and reflecting the past successful movements. But we have also need to recognize that those movements are facing even more challenges than before. We talk about the authoritarian backlash in that context, that oftentimes authoritarians would recognize the power of those nonviolent movements or the people power much more than people themselves. And here we've got aspiring, very encouraging examples, but in a number of cases, those movements, yes, they learn each from each other, but actually authoritarians learn as well. And they come with a lot of sophisticated instruments to counter the movements. And in fact, my colleagues are showing that in the last 5 years, the effectiveness of nonviolent movements, it decreased when they challenge oppressive governments. It doesn't mean that the effectiveness of armed resistance against those oppressive regimes increased. Actually, it's also declined. But in absolute terms, nonviolent movements are not faring so well like before. And so movements are learning from each other, from the successes as well as from failures, but the adversaries are no less steep in learning the kind of more authoritarian, more targeted and more kind of smarter way of countering those movements. In fact, authoritarians, they would adopt for their own purposes nonviolent actions. Vladimir Putin, president of Russia, after color revolutions, he created encouraged creation of its own nonviolent pro-government movement that would protect the government. That's actually indicative of the extent to which those dictators would recognize the power of nonviolent movements, but they would use them for their own nefarious ends. So movements, they need to learn, yes, from one another, from past movements, but they need to get more strategic in terms of addressing new challenges posed by the adversaries.
Thanks, Matt. You're gonna have the last word here.
I have two paths I want us to go on. One reflected on some of the things that I heard, Darren, you pushing us towards, and one from some of the things I heard the groups push us towards. You know, we began this conversation talking about global crises, and I think I wanted to reflect on global opportunities, because I also think that's what this moment is about. And I want to say, I was privileged to be able to hang out with that group way back there. You know who you are way back there. Yeah, I'm talking about you guys. And I feel like they said a bunch of stuff that was reflective of, Elevi, what you were saying, about the journey. Yeah? And I guess I wanted to say, as a piece of that, that in one's own life, and you know, I'm big in the institutions, but I can do the interpersonal stuff too. In one's own life, one may find different moments when one is willing to take this risk or the other. And there's no right way, because you can choose more than one. At this moment, I'm parenting a three-year-old. So, I'm not actually. I'm just saying, hypothetically. So I'm not going to risk a lot of civil disobedience that's going to land me in jail. That's irresponsible. But at that moment, I will. So one can make more than one choice on this journey. I mean, Gandhi himself, titled his own autobiography, The Story of My Experiments with Truth. It was about experimentation. And Barbara Deming, who wrote the key piece vis-a-vis Franz Fanon, talked about revolution and equilibrium. How to build an equilibrium into our nonviolence, our revolutionary nonviolence. I'm going to get back to that phrase in a moment. But when we look at global opportunities at this moment, I feel like we have as many of the hidden, forgotten, not spotlighted things going on now as we did in that history book. We can almost put out another volume. And I just wanted to recall a few. I think it's completely correct that we in the US are behind movements in Africa and elsewhere, that we are catching up. Although I do have to say, as a cautionary note, we must remember there's Bernie Sanders and there's Donald Trump. Not to say that we should be focusing on electoral politics at all. But since you brought Bernie into the room, I have to bring Donald into the room as well and remind us that at this moment, and in all moments in history everywhere, but at this moment in U.S. history, it's not a linear thing. Eh? Two steps forward, two steps back. But it is a thing where there's lots that we are learning from things that other countries, other regions, other places have been through already. So, for example, the article that Darren put out there that I wrote about nonviolent statecraft and Zambia in the 1960s reflects on some of the questions about how to use nonviolence when you become the president of a country through mainly nonviolent. This is stuff that Kenneth Kaunda faced. How do you deal with those issues? Well, we haven't ever really, as a country, as a younger country, dealt with those things. I'm thinking about the article I read from Angola just recently about this group of Angolan youth who were just given these harsh sentences for essentially reading one of Gene Sharp's books, translated from Dictatorship to Democracy. I'm thinking of the Indian leader that we quote in our article in Exploring the Power of Nonviolence, Narayan Desai, who just passed, who talked about what he called it in India, total revolution. But it was total revolution through what he called love force. Not just soul force or truth force, satyagraha, but love force. I'm thinking about the Palestinian advocates of nonviolent sanctions against companies that support Israeli apartheid. I'm thinking of the current movement against corruption and the ongoing economic apartheid in South Africa today. I'm thinking of the thing you just said about colonialism and ongoing colonialism and the Puerto Rican freedom movements of today, working for the release of the current political prisoner Oscar Lopez Rivera, who's called the Mandela of the Americas, and who most of us have never even heard of. And I guess when I think of these things, I'm thinking of a new term that some of us are beginning to investigate, a new paradigm. Because, by the way, I think one of the important things about the studies that Maciej was citing is that this is a very, very new field. We are just the beginning of doing this kind of research. We need a lot more people doing a lot more research along just those lines. And so when we're looking at paradigms and we're looking at definitions, there are some of us who are talking more and more about this term revolution and this term nonviolence, neither one of which are particularly well-defined, particularly well-clarified in our work. So what if there was a revolutionary nonviolence? What if there was a moment, and I think we're at that moment, where we, this generation, new generations, are refusing to choose between Malcolm and Martin, refusing to accept that there's a dichotomy between revolution and nonviolence. In fact, don't believe the hype, they're closer than you think. Just as those two men were moving closer in internationalism and Pan-Africanism, in economic analysis. Just read James Cone, America, the Dream or the Nightmare. And you'll see that maybe we are at a new moment in talking about this, in reclaiming King's radicalism and revitalizing King for the 21st century. Maybe we're talking about a revolutionary nonviolence that is the new paradigm for the 21st century.
Thank you. Thank you, LV, Matt, and Maciej, for your time, your thoughts. Thanks to all of you in the audience. Thanks to our folks who are watching online. Unassassinating this person and all the people that he worked with and organized with around this practice of nonviolence on a personal level, a community level, and an international level. We cannot forget that the last conversation he had in that hotel room the night before he went to bed on April 3rd with some of his colleagues was their wish that what they had experimented with in the United States with the Civil Rights Movement, that Dr. King said his wish was to institutionalize and internationalize the practice of nonviolence. And I think some of the stories that we've heard here today are an example that we are moving in that direction. And one thing I want to reference too, one of my colleagues corrected the announcement to this event that made it seem like violent conflict has been on the rise and it's getting worse and worse and worse. But in fact, cases of violence has actually gone down year after year. Yes, there's fits and starts, take two steps forward, one step back. But we are moving towards a way of waging struggle that does not rely on violence.
and remembering what Dr. King stood for, and others before him and after him have shown us and modeled for us and challenged us to think about, is how do we wage struggle without resorting to violence? How do we transform societies and build a just peace by being forceful? So I encourage you all to keep those words with you today and days forward. And it is beautiful out. And before it rains, if you have time today, take the time, go to the MLK Memorial, stand there and be present with all the people who are there. Read some of those quotes and press on. So thank you all. Thanks to our online audience. And we can mingle a bit outside.